Thank you. Dear Mr. Danfried, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen, for me it's really a great pleasure to be here for the third time, I think. And ICD organizes this such activities excellent, and also with different states here, and to it is the possibility to exchange a lot of views for different problems linked with judiciary, with politics, with different issues which have to do also with integration, problems of globalization, and so on. That's the reason why, or through, we are making the judicial reform now in Albania. I found time to come here for 2 days because it's, I repeat, it's really a great pleasure and honor to be here. So I will speak about constitutional justice and politics. So it's, let's say, a provocative subject, but to make it simply, relations between constitutional court and parliament. What are the joint points and what are their duties? How they influence each other? So we all know that in democracy as form of governance, the state power, it's divided in three powers. So it's the idea of Montesquieu, well known, beginning from his very well-known book, De l'Esprit des Lois. So it is divided comparing the state power in Turkey, where Sultan had at that time legislative, executive, and judiciary power. He called such a regime as a tyranny. He said that in a democratic state, normally, in a democracy like its form of governance, the state power should be divided, because in such a way it is possible to avoid the risk of concentration of power, because normally we all know that the concentration of power in one hand raises the risk of abuse of power, and that the power is distributed in several organs with different functions and tasks. Later on, after the idea of Montesquieu, also developed from many other authors, it is implemented in practice for the first time in the United States of America. And we all know that the Constitution of the United States of America speaks for check and balance, division of power, but also check and balance. And it was the first time in which it was really implemented, and of course, since then, it is implemented in all democratic states as one of the main requirements for a democracy as form of governance. But it was raised immediately the problem, I will try to simplify, to ensure or to find an institution, a constitutional institution, an arbiter is needed to guarantee the Constitution and to make its final interpretation. Who will guarantee the division of powers, the values of a democratic institutions? Because it was said quite rightly that it is needed to oversee the way the principles and standards are observed, to make judicial review, to control also the laws, if they are also in conformity with the Constitution, and to control the use of constitutional power by public institutions. The time are developed a lot of theories. We have not time, not too much time to develop and to go in details about these different theories, especially during the Weimar Republic. Distinguished jurists made a contribution on this topic, like Hans Kelsen, Carl Schmitt, George Jelinek, Rudolf Smet, and so on. I am not mentioning all, but at least quite shortly, because it's really very, very interesting. Also, as regard the subject we are speaking today, constitutional justice and politics, I will concentrate shortly to Hans Kelsen and then to Carl Schmitt. Hans Kelsen's approach was quite simple. The guardian of the Constitution should be a separate judicial organ, namely the Constitutional Court, as a special organ to guarantee the Constitution and to make its final interpretation. Carl Schmitt, for a long time, they exchanged a lot of letters between them, Carl Schmitt and Hans Kelsen, discussing about that subject. Carl Schmitt said at that time that the guarant, and he wrote a book with the title The Guarant of the Constitution. Among others, Carl Schmitt said at that time that the guardian of the Constitution should be the president of the Republic and not a judicial organ, not a constitutional court. He said that, among others, that the Constitution is a result of a compromise between different political forces. So if it is, if the a court intervenes, the court disbalances the political compromises, which is really a big problem. So for Schmitt at the time. He spoke that in such a way we can go to the politicization of justice and juridification of politics. It means, according to Carl Schmitt, that politicization of justice, or let's say a justice which is politicized, it's not anymore justice. And a politics, juridification of politics, a politics which has limits, is not able to react to the political and social problems raised in a national level. He also added another argument. He said that the final decision, it's not possible to give the right to have the final decision to a court, to the judges, because the final decision tells who is sovereign in the state, and the final decision to give to the judges, it remember to us the monarchy or dictatorship, because they are not sovereign. They are elected. They don't go periodically for the elections. They are appointed, not elected, and also they have not political responsibility. But without discussing more, of course, the Kelsen's approach resulted more efficient, and also it was implemented in practice. So it is called mainly the European model, because we all know that, in fact, the institution of the judicial review, which is one of the main competences of the constitutional court now in the continental system, has the beginning. It was as an institution to the American constitutionalism, this famous case Marbury and Madison. It was the first case in which it was developed, or it was said from Judge Marshall that also the constitutional court has the Supreme Court, has the right to control and to declare unconstitutional a law. Today, we all know that we have two forms of judicial review: decentralized, the Anglo-Saxon system is decentralized because all courts can do that, being or having in the top of the system the Supreme Court, and centralized, which means that we have the constitutional courts. And in such a way, constitutional courts are the most effective constitutional mechanism for guaranteeing the faithful enforcement of principles and values underpinning the rule of law, building and maintaining a free and democratic society, functioning of the institution on basis of the principle of separation and balancing of powers, and protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms. Now, shortly, which are the powers of the constitutional courts everywhere, normally? Constitutional control of, or first, guaranteeing the priority of the Constitution. Secondly, constitutional control of compliance of law with the Constitution, the so-called, we mentioned before, judicial review. Solving conflicts between different state powers. To control referendum's constitutionality and verification of its results. To control the constitutionality of political parties and other political organizations, to remove from office the President of the Republic and verification of the impossibility to exercise his functions, twice is made in the last 5 years from the newest, very new constitutional court in Kosovo. They declared twice the impossibility of the president of the republic to be in that position. And also hearing individual constitutional complaints about claims of violation of human rights, as we mentioned. Which are now the main principles? If we have in mind the powers of the Constitutional Court, it is quite clear that the main principles and values elaborated from the Constitutional Court are: constitutional courts have taken an active role in shaping of, and sometimes even in conditioning or generating of, the legislative policy of the country. Secondly, especially important, a visible political role of the constitutional courts in transition processes in Central and Eastern European countries and their EU integration. I will come back especially in the case of Albania later on. And also reshaping the legal system and balancing of the conflict of the political powers. Also, it is quite often mentioned that the Constitutional Court is also a very effective mean at the hands of the opposition in a democratic society. In a book, Kirchhoff, a very well-known ex-judge and now a professor of constitutional law, has mentioned that instead of going to the streets to protest, the opposition have the right to go to the Constitutional Court and to protect their interests, political interests, to Parliament. Of course, we all know that the German system inspired a lot of especially new democracies in Central and Eastern Europe. German Constitutional Court is one of the most authoritative constitutional court. He has for more than 60 years shaped the course and the character of the German politics, has protected principles of democracy, rule of law, and fundamental rights, has protected the open democratic society, free and democratic order. This is also very important. Constitutionalizing human rights, also mentioning the decision of the German Constitutional Court as an objective system of values applicable in all branches of state power, legislative, executive, and in judiciary too. Now, which are the relations with the lawmaking process? The Constitutional Court is empowered to invalidate laws, we mentioned, among others, passed by the legislator that are deemed contrary to the Constitution, thereby conditioning the direct or indirect legislative choice made by the legislator, and secondly, shifting from its traditional role as a negative legislator and taking off features of a positive legislator. More than 100 years ago, Hans Kelsen spoke about constitutional court, but thinking always as a negative legislator, only to declare the unconstitutionality of laws. Now, in a lot of cases, including also the German constitutional court, the constitutional court also, they don't prepare exactly the laws, but also they leave quite often to the legislator precise tasks or deadlines for carrying out certain mandatory actions. So we have a direct impact, declaration of unconstitutional of an act of parliament, it is quite clear, an indirect effect, a self-restrained and more prudent position on the part of the legislator in process of enacting laws. So they have to see what constitutional courts have said before, according to the different standard used and needed in a democratic society. So we come, let's say, in a mini conclusion that there is a natural and inevitable affinity of constitutional court with the policymakers, and this can be considered as a co-participation in the process of determining the state policy direction, mainly because of the judicial review. Uh, Also, it's a very important role, I mentioned before, of the Constitutional Court to resolve the conflicts between state authorities, state organs. Because in a democratic society, of course, it's needed, a proper functioning of the public authority of the state and their mutual relations. And also this principle, it is in the essence or regard, it's the principle of constitutional loyalty elaborated from different constitutional court, especially from the German constitutional court. The principle of constitutional loyalty. In German, it is the principle of Verfassungstreu. Verfassungstreu means that the state organs has the duty to collaborate with each other to solve the problems and not to create problems, not to create conflicts. This is also now one of the main principles which is in the base of the functioning of the European Union institutions too. The principle of constitutional duality, or the principle of the so-called Verfassungstreu. In fact, this principle, the principle of constitutional duality, constitutes an extension of the principle of separation of power, and it expressed the mutual respect from each authority about the powers of other authorities. This is especially a big problem, especially in new democracies, in which it happens quite often, that president has conflicts with parliament, and parliament also has problems with executive, and so on. And sometimes it is blocked. Let's mention, for example, the Albanian case, huh? Especially in the period of cohabitation, during the periods in which the president of the republic, which sometimes it's very powerful, it has a lot of competences in judiciary, like in Albania before, not with according to the new changings in the constitution, and he doesn't agree with the proposals, or contrary the parliament with the proposals of the president. Let's mention two simple things. According to the Albanian constitution, ex-constitution, judges in the Supreme Court and in the Constitutional Court were elected through the proposal of the president, and then the proposal of the president was needed to be voted from the simple majority in parliament. And there are 5 years in which the president of the republic, coming from now the opposition, now it's another majority in parliament, make proposals, for judges in constitutional court and in the Supreme Court, and the parliament doesn't vote them because they said we don't agree with the candidates. And practically it's blocked. That's the reason, one of the reasons that this formula is changed, and I will mention. So coming back to this, because to understand the principle of the constitutional loyalty, it seeks quite, and it's elaborated especially through the jurisprudence of the German constitutional court, it seeks the cooperation between state institutions because they are there to function, to respect constitutional obligations, and also to serve to the people. Another very important competence, as I mentioned before, it's protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms. Sometimes constitutional courts are called also as main mechanism, effective mechanism to protect human rights and fundamental freedoms in national level. And they do it in different ways, through individual complaints, but also through the so-called incidental control. Individual claims, it's very much developed in Germany, the so-called Verfassungsbeschwerde. It's very much developed. But also through the incidental control. It's developed especially in Italy. The Court of Cassation, the judges in all levels can stop, suspend judgment, concrete judgment, and they present the case to the Constitutional Court because the judge says or thinks that the law needed to be applied in the concrete case, it's against the Constitution. Also, especially all constitutional courts in all countries, but especially in new democracies, are assisted a lot through the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights in that direction, and they have given a huge assistance to create an open democratic society and to respect effectively human rights and fundamental freedoms in national level. Of course, it depends. The place and the role that international law in general, and especially the European Convention of Human Rights, has in the national legal system. But generally speaking, the decisions of the European Court of Human Rights has practically, not officially, but practically, they have an erga omnes effect. So, shortly about the legislator. The legislator, in which points can intervene, let's say, or can have impact to the organization and functioning of the constitutional courts? Of course, the legislator plays an important role, or the parliaments, in determining the constitutive and functional rules of the constitutional court through fixing criteria and procedures of appointment of constitutional judges, through fixing powers and competences of the constitutional court, through modalities to refer cases to the constitutional court. The impact they have for the implementation of the decisions of the constitutional court, and so on. In Albania, of course, it was for more than 50 years in a communist dictatorship. After the changings in 91, 92, in 92 it was created the Constitutional Court, and this Constitutional Court has developed new constitutional standards and also has found a lot of sharp problems of Albania society. Let's say, to engaged in a different, very sensitive cases. It has had an orientation compass of the respect for the constitution, to the protection of values and principles of democratic state, as well as affirmation and protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms. There are a lot of decisions, very sensitive decisions, given from the Constitutional Court of Albania, and also are developed a lot of new principles not expressly stated in the constitution, like the principle of legal certainty, the principle of constitutional loyalty, the principle of clarity and accuracy of legal arms, the principle of acquired rights, the principle of equality of arms, and so on. But as cases, we can mention shortly some cases, for example, the abolition of the death penalty as incompatible with the Constitution of the Republic of Albania. This was made 16 years ago in a decision of the Constitutional Court of 2000. The decision for the so-called lustration law. The decision about the delimitation of the sea between Albania and Greece, considering this agreement as unconstitutional. The decision about the publication, the possibility of the publication of assets statements and elected persons and some other public officials. The decision, there are in fact some decisions on the right of property, particularly upon the issue of the restitution and compensation of property to former owners expropriated during the communist regime, as it was mentioned also from my colleague, the Vice President of the Supreme Court of Romania. And it has cooperated, especially in the sensitive, because there are a lot of very political questions which are very sensitive. And also in new democracies, the problems brought between different political parties and interests, especially between the majority and opposition, are very problematic sometimes, like actually the problem of the judicial reform. So that's the reason why the Constitutional Court has used also to cooperate quite often with the Venice Commission. You know, it's a group of experts. Every member of the European Council of Europe has one representative, a prominent constitutionalist, and also they are ready in many cases to give advisory opinions about difficult issues raised, I repeat, especially in the new democracies, especially for the countries in Europe, in Central and Eastern Europe. So, coming again to the constitutional amendments, now we are making a reform, and as I mentioned before, I've picked two problems. Constitutional amendment, it's a political conflict. For example, the composition and appointments of the judges. As I mentioned before, it was necessary, according to the constitution we had before, and now it's amended 3 or 4 months ago. President proposals to parliament, but it's not functioning since 5 years. Instead of being in the Supreme Court, actually, 19 judges, we are 14 judges, because nobody is there to elect them before making the reform. The same in Constitutional Court. 2 vacancies, practically. So now it's changed the formula, and it is said that, yes, it is the French system, but there are different systems. 3 judges will be appointed from President of the Republic, 3 judges appointed from Parliament, and 3 judges appointed from the High Court, all members of the High Court, to vote. But proposals will come from a special mechanism. It's a special unit, a special mechanism, who will filter first the candidates, and then this mechanism will propose, according to a list, candidates to the President of the Republic, Parliament, and the High Court, the plenary session of the High Court. It's the most sensitive question in the last years, but especially during these days. That's the reason why I'm not going to speak a lot about that, because it's the vetting process. As a beginning, it is supposed to begin the judicial reform in Albania through a vetting process. It's through which will go all judges and prosecutors and legal advisors of the Constitutional Court and in the Supreme Court. During this process, it will be controlled, the ability of them to be in such a position, the property, and also the figure of the judges and prosecutors. The opposition brought, it was approved in Parliament through amendments there, but the opposition brought it in the Constitutional Court. The Constitutional Court sent it, put 4 questions in the Venice Commission. They answered 3 days ago or 4 days ago that everything is okay. It is a violation, but it is through the margin of appreciation. It is acceptable, and now we are waiting the decision of the Constitutional Court, and all political parties are attacking, let's say, the Constitutional Court and waiting for the decision of the Constitutional Court, although that for the main issues, four problems, let's say, the Venice Commission said that there are no problems, constitutional problems, with that law, with the law on the vetting. So, to conclude now, I can say that there are close connections between the legislator and constitutional courts in fulfilling their constitutional obligations. Of course, the place and the role of each of the constitutional court and the legislator in democracy are quite different, but based in the principle of the constitutional duality, In the exercise of their duties, they should coordinate and complement each other in terms of better interpretation and application of constitutional norms and principles. Each of them should try to do the best within the so-called margin of appreciation to solve the problems. Just as Judge Cardozo, American judge, has said, the final cause of a law is the welfare of the society. So, yeah, to interpret and apply it in the positive sense. And also, it should be mentioned the role of the Constitutional Court of the Western Balkans in the integration process, which is not an aim, let's say, in itself. But first of all, because we all know that European Union, it's not simple. It's a international organization sui generis, and it's a union of values because it is based in such values like principles of democracy, rule of law, and fundamental rights. And we have to respect them, new states who want to be part of the European Union, and this is not a simple requirement, but also it's for the sake to improve the situations of our countries and of our people in our country. So I try to be short, but I am now ready to answer your questions.
Thank you very much. Yes, now we are ready to open the floor for our audience with question and comment, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Dixon Omorigi from Nigeria. While you opened, you said the essence of judiciary is to balance the political compromise. We all know that in a conventional court sitting, the good guys always lose. Why the bad guys always win? Maybe because of the cost of litigation or connections. My question here is there any external control or regulation of the judiciary in case of abuse? My question is external control, or the penalty is simply an in-house penalty? In-house penalty against the judges who has abused their power.
Of course, judges who abuse their power, they should be responsible. But I mentioned, as you say, about the disbalance of the compromises. I mentioned it in the framework of the discussion 400 years ago between Kelsen and Schmidt. It was a very interesting discussion at the time. And Schmidt says that a constitution is a result, the result of a compromise between different political parties, because in essence. That's the reason why giving to the judges persons who are not elected and who don't have political responsibility, it's not normal. Not Kelsen, not me, it was said from Carl Schmitt. Because interpreting the constitution, they will decide in such a way that they will disbalance the interests or the compromise achieved between different political parties. He was not right, he was wrong. Because now we all know that the Constitution is a product of not, let's say, a simple discussion between political parties. They should have, but there are specialists, and they are also me, there are a lot of experiences and of course, it's not at the hands of one, two, or three, or 10 political parties. So, but it was the idea at the time of the Carl Schmitt that not to leave the discussion or the interpretation of law and also the constitutionality of the laws to decide persons who are not elected. Because he said that every 4 years, Politicians go for elections. They are responsible. But judges, no. Sometimes they are forever there, in the Supreme Court and the Constitutional Court. This was the discussion I mentioned in such a way. But for the abuse of rights, of course, like other persons, they should be responsible judges, of course.
Abuse of power by the judges, so I'm saying.
Powers by the, yes, of course. Now, the impact of the decisions of the judges, also it's in politics. We saw it quite clear. There are decisions taken from politics, and they say no, because the law you have approved, it's against the Constitution, because they know better how to interpret the Constitution. So that's the reason why in the conclusions I say that should be balanced the interest between legislator and also the Constitutional Court. They should find a balance between each other. Sometimes it's not easy, but they should find it. And we have, I mentioned the German Constitutional Court. It's an excellent court. Everybody accepts that. Bundesverfassungsgericht, it's an excellent court. But sometimes also the German Constitutional Court, the different decisions of the German Constitutional Court are discussed and criticized from different cases, in different cases. What to say then for constitutional courts in new democracies? Yes, please.
You made a lot of emphasis.
Please?
You made a lot of emphasis on the separation of powers.
Yes.
Which I think is accepted today. But then you analyze the powers of the Constitutional Court, and you gave the impression...
And the legislator too.
Yeah, huh? I got the impression that the Constitutional Court can be, in some instances, an instrument of legislation. That means that it tends to...
They influence the legislator, yes.
Now, do you agree with me that the Constitution is supreme?
Yes.
And even the legislator is subject to the Constitution, and the courts are subject to the Constitution?
Yes.
Therefore, won't you agree with me that the role of the Constitutional Court should be limited to interpreting the Constitution, and whether it is right that once a Constitutional Court decision decides that the legislative instrument is against the Constitution, that should be binding on the legislator. But that is the extent to which the Constitutional Court should legislate. Otherwise, you will end up with conflict between powers, and not with the separation of powers. And for that line, that fine line, which you, in fact, you mentioned, that fine line between the two powers, basically, it has to be very, very pronounced. It's subtle, but it has to be pronounced.
Yes, I agree with it.
It shouldn't be, because there is a very strong tendency from constitutional courts to legislate through judgments. Mm-hmm. And that can be dangerous. That can be dangerous. I mean, it's true that in interpreting provision, one can actually legislate. Mm-hmm. Because one can say, if you interpret a constitutional provision in such a way, you have an effect, a legitimate effect. Okay? Mm-hmm. That I agree. But you have to be very careful. It's not. The constitutional court shouldn't take too much on itself.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you. But I agree fully with you. That's the reason why, especially in judiciary, but especially for the Constitutional Court, is to say that the constitutional judges should respect the so-called principle of self-restraint. They should not be very active. They should interpret the Constitution. But from the other side, we all know that the life is very dynamic. Things change, and things need to be interpreted. Let's take human rights. Now, as a result of the development of science and technology, we have social media. Where are the limits of social media in privacy? And what are the where should be found the balance between the freedom of expression? It's very good. It's development. But also between the private life and family life. We have problems of development of medicine, linked euthanasia, with the transplant of organs, and with a lot of problems linked with bioethics or with the so-called biomedicine. Who has to interpret that? Only the Constitutional Court should interpret that according to the main principles of the Constitution. Let's say for private life, or things linked with other articles, the right to life, and also with the other.
These issues you mentioned are very real, and they are being debated in most countries.
Yes, but there are different solutions.
But ultimately, who should take the decision? Shouldn't it be the legislator to decide whether euthanasia is legal or not? I mean, it's good for the Constitutional Court.
Both.
We have to be careful, very careful.
Yeah, of course. Otherwise, but the legislature cannot change the laws every week or every.
My idea is that we can't have courts creating rights. Rights are created through legislation. Okay? Legislation, the courts are there to interpret legislation. At a certain point, it's the legislature who will decide whether, because what's happening even for Salzburg, you're having Salzburg deciding cases which in effect create new rights. Which might not be accepted in a state.
Yes.
I mean, it's not easy to say.
It's not easy. It depends from the cases. You are quite right. I repeat, the principle of self-restraint, it's one of the main principles. But let's take two examples. One of the cases discussed in Germany in the last years, I am taking examples from Germany because you know maybe the better the jurisprudence of Germany. I will mention three cases. The case of Gergen, if you remember, the case of Gergen. Germany was condemned for torture and inhuman treatment because the police wanted to find where and wanted to save the life of a child, 11-year-old. And he was found responsible. Or let's take the case Carolina of Monaco against Germany. In Germany, it was said the Constitutional Court too, because it depends from the interpretation. It is the same. The law, the convention, also the Constitution, the Grundgesetz, protects the family and private life. But in the balance with the Article 10, with the freedom of expression, it's not easy to find the balance. Who has to find it? In Germany, the Constitutional Court said quite clear that these persons are persons for par excellence, and they also, in the framework of the freedom of expression, Carolina of Monaco had to accept the, let's say, intervention to private life. And it was the decision of the Constitutional Court. But what said then Strasbourg? The President of Strasbourg said another thing. Also raised the question, where is the public interest here? Because there were also pictures of her son. And in that case also, and the prominent, or let's say the persons par excellence, has private life. If there is no interest to the public, why you have to intervene to the private life of the persons? But you know, two very prominent, excellent courts, different solutions. That's the reason why it is needed, the contact. Because now we have a multi-level system. We have the Luxembourg too. It's a multi-level system on the protection of human rights. In national level, all courts, Supreme Courts, Constitutional Courts, the Court of Strasbourg, the Court of Luxembourg, how to manage it. Of course it is needed to have the dialogue between judges and to find right decisions. And these are not only things linked with legislator, things linked with the way judges are obliged to interpret the norms of the constitutions and so I think.
Excellent. I think on that note we should come to a conclusion, but thank you very much for the keynote address and also for the questions and dialogue that occurred.
Thank you.
Express our sincere dialogue.